down the hammer and pick up the pencil. You're about to listen to the Savvy Radio Show. Learn from real-life real estate investors, experience revealed with the Savvy Landlord as your host.
Hey, hey, you tuned in to the Savvy Radio Show podcast, Savvy Podcast, Savvy something, somewhere, somehow. Hopefully you're doing good. Hey, man, I got a great response from the walkthrough episode I just did last week, so kind of stoked about it, so I'm down for another one. And maybe we'll try to do these every Wednesday so we can be consistent, which is success is consistency, period. You know this. You don't need to hear it again. You just need a reminder. So we're going to do walkthrough Wednesday. Thanks to my boy, Brian Long out there. Yep, I'm giving a shout out to you, homie, for just encouragement, loving on a brother, and giving me some great ideas and some pointers and tips. And it just helped me, motivated me, and that's what life is. We got to be encouraging one another, and I can't say that enough. And I know it seems like I've been saying that on every episode, but iron sharpens iron. It is not easy or cheesy to be a real estate investor in the trenches. There's times when everything is going great until the first of the month, and then there's an eviction going down, and then you evict that person, and it's several thousand dollars later. You just never know. That could be on the 15th of the month. And so you just never know where anyone is at in their life. Things happen. Medical reports come back that are not favorable. And so the least what we can do is just constantly encourage people. If you want to be a superstar, and I got to give a shout out to my homie that wrote me a letter. I mean, it took the time to type in a letter. Maybe you should go to the next level and really write a letter to somebody that you love and care, especially your parents. And it's the time of the year that we need to be thankful. So let's go through this walkthrough Wednesday. So an easy topic for me and a passion for me is bank funding, aka money, commercial money. And so I'm just going to do broad strokes. I've actually started a book on this several years ago, about 60% done, and then I realized people don't read books. So, but if this subject really motivated you and you need some more details on it, I have a ton of it. So I'm just going to kind of just walk you through the process of bank funding, kind of the basics of what's going down, and some tips and tricks to make it happen for you. So I'm going to walk you through the process. Number one, you got to determine exactly what type of funding you need. There is regular conventional funding, what normal average people think real estate is. It's like you go get a loan with a loan broker, and now we can break off loan brokers later, or a bank, and that, you know, they just assume, and I get this all the time, that you have to put down 20%. I was actually chatting with a dude this weekend at a wrestling match, and he's like, don't you have to put 20% down? No, that is a fallacy in commercial money. That is true in conventional money. Typical average bank funding, typical average money for a typical average person trying to get a home loan, okay? As a real estate investor, they don't teach you this, and so you want to get commercial money, aka portfolio money. And you know, some people get confused between lines of credit and guidance lines, and you know, maybe this is not the episode for that. But the point is, you got to know what type of funding you need. And the funding that I work in all the time is commercial money, also known as portfolio money. Now, you got to find out from the bank what type of lending do they do. There is banks that just specialize in commercial lending, portfolio lending. And then there's banks, and majority of them, probably 90% of them, are conventional, where they just are looking for loans to right people, and then they sell that loan to a bigger bank, to a hedge fund, or to the open market is another terminology. And so that's everywhere and anywhere on every corner. But you're looking for a unique bank, not unique in the sense that they're rare, but a bank that really specializes in commercial money. Now, there is some rare banks that have a mortgage department, a real estate department, and just regular loans. So, but the banks that I'm talking about are small banks that kind of do everything, and they may specialize, or their thrust of business is commercial. So those are the banks that I work with, and those are the banks I recommend that you work with. Now, I've helped people all over the country raise funds through commercial lending, borrowing, and there's also companies that just specialize, and these are kind of like a private money institution that loans money commercially, but they follow the guidelines as a commercial lender. So we got that out of the way. The first thing you need to do to walk you through is get a referral. I just got a letter from my friend the other day, and he's like, I just dropped a bank name in the executive that runs that bank department, and he got a loan just on a referral. Some, hey, Stephen Van Kallenberg told me about your bank. That was it. Now, of course, he had to do his financial statement and properly a credibility kit per se or a resume, and we can go into that. That's something someone just recently asked me about. You know, how do you produce a credibility kit? And if that's something, if I get like three or four people interested in that, I mean, I'll drop that for you as well, how I do it. But the point is, you got to get a referral. So you can easily get a referral at your local real estate club meeting. There's majority of all real estate investors get money at the same place. So one of my bankers is retiring after 27 years. And I noticed there was like three or four other investors at this retirement party that I never knew that used the same bank that I use. And so that's an easy way to get a referral. Hey, who? Now you have to be respectful. Don't just run up to somebody and say, yo, what bank do you use? You know, you want to start a conversation with someone and maybe lead with, hey, I'm using this bank. Have you had any luck with this bank? Or who's the bank that you're using? And if you come across the same bank, obviously, that's exactly the bank that you should pursue. And what you need to do is go after local banks. I like banks that are $250 million in assets and below. A really nimble bank that can move within 7 days, 3 days, is usually a bank that's about $50 million and below. I mean, they have one branch. They have a couple of employees. That's the bank that you're looking for. A bank that's $250 million in assets, have several, maybe three locations, branches, whatever you want to call them. And so there's just give you some perspective. So you want to look for the typical term community bank. And then when you understand now after today forward, you know what you're looking for, a community bank. You're looking for a referral on that community bank. And then what you need to do is do the research. Go to the website, their website, and read about their loan officers. So a lot of people get confused on the president or vice president or these titles. Okay, so let's just be clear. There's usually one president, and he usually has a main interest in the bank, meaning he has some equity in the bank. He's on the board of directors, usually on a smaller bank. Now, that president will have a vice president. Now, here's the problem. With the small banks, a vice president really is a vice president to the president. But on a larger bank, let's just say $500 million, there might be three or four or two vice presidents. And so then they throw in senior vice president. Look beyond the title. You may be calling on a vice president, and they may be just a generic, average, lower-level loan officer. Okay, it's not to be negative, but the titles of these loan officers are just passed around like candy, and they just incentivize these loan officers by giving them a good title, makes them feel good, get them a business card, so on and so forth. Now, of course, some bankers just hate me, so whatever. But that's the reality. And now, so you can't be delusional about their title. You got to really, if you know, you can be delusional if they're a vice president, if there's only one president. So how many vice presidents are in the bank? That's, you don't want to come out and say it like that, but you can find that information all on their website. You need to read how long they've been in business. Has it generational? Is it family owned? Is there shares? Is there a board of directors? Okay. So do your research on their bank. Now, you got to know what you want and what you're looking for, because the first question they're going to ask you, what's your goals? And you got to be ready to be prepared. The dumb rookie investor, yeah, I want to buy 5 houses this week or 10 houses this month or whatever. No, you've got to talk their language. You've got to know their terminology. They are very conservative. If they weren't conservative, they wouldn't be a banker. They're not real estate investors. They may act like it because they know our language, because they've worked in the industry long enough, but they usually don't have assets. It's extremely rare. I'm talking like super duper rare to have a real estate banker that owns real estate. It's not impossible. It's rare. So first of all, you as a real estate investor are an entrepreneur, and them are just staff members of a bank, aka an employee. They have a job. They make $100,000 a year. They got this cushy job. They get bonuses. They get quotas. Okay. So your language of push, 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 win, 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 risk, 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 they are slow, slow, slow. Five C's of credibility, character. Google the five C's of banking up, and you'll understand that. You know, that's another podcast, I would assume. But they have a different mindset. They do everything by ratios about your portfolio. What's your cash flow? Are you able to pay it back? Okay. So you got to learn the terminology. That's the first thing. You know, what is a ratio? What's your ratio of how they determine that you're bankable? So, and the only way you can do that is kind of by getting mentored by another investor that has a lot of experience working with banks. Or if you're fortunate enough, which is totally possible, these are human beings, men and women, they enjoy coffee, they enjoy lunches, they enjoy asking questions. When I started 20 years ago, I literally had no idea, just like you. And so I just started asking the questions authentically. And I mean, there were stupid questions you would sound. How does the bank make money? What's arbitrage? Why does the Fed loan you money, and why is it regulated? And can you do your own money? What's so benefit about deposits? And so if you've ever come across a banker, the first thing that skilled banker should do, why don't you move your money to my bank and make a deposit? And so you're like, why is he asking me that? Well, the point is that they need deposits because they have a factor of what they can loan out. For every dollar they have, they can loan it. I think it's like 10 or 4 times. I probably need to sharpen up my skills here, but I think it's 10 times the amount. So if they have $1 million in deposits, I think they can either loan out $4 million or $10 million, or it's a factor of a number. And so that's why they always are beckoning for you to have a deposit, because the more deposits they have in their bank, the federal government allows them to loan out more money in a factor. I believe it's a factor of 10. I'm probably wrong. So if you know that answer, if any bankers listen to this, they probably don't. But if someone does know that, hey, let your boy know. Text me, because it would be fascinating just to make sure I can get that out there. And so you need to set a meeting up with this banker. So after you found this banker, interview this person by face-to-face if possible. I remember vividly a person that I was referred to, and I set up an appointment. And I just sat across his table at his desk and just see if I, you know, again, I'm a real experienced real estate investor, but just to see if we can do business together. And that's what this is about. You don't want to get in a relationship with a banker, and when their hands are tied and there's a decision, you know, a policy exception that needs to happen, or you need to push a deal through, or you're going to lose the deal. You want to interview this individual and find out what their skill set is as analyzing numbers. Do they understand your language as a real estate investor? Do they know the timetable? Do they know that if you're going to be flipping a property, is that going to be a conflict of interest for the bank? Meaning, how long do they want you to season the loan? Meaning, how long do they want to receive interest on it? You want to know during this interview, what's their fee structure? Do you do points? Is there a prepaid penalty? What's your AM rate? You know, amortization. These are terms that you need to learn and know. Origination fee. Is there a doc fee? Do they require a title insurance? Do they require a title report? If you want to refi, is there a way to save money? Are they thinking about saving you money? Are they thinking about charging you fees for things? So these are just things that you kind of just need to know, terminology. And then you kind of want to interview that individual and see if you can get that data. Now, here's the interesting thing you need to be aware of. When you're going to interview a bank, in your mind, they are going to interview you. So they're going to ask you these questions like, what's your goals? Are you a full-time investor? How do you manage your money? Where does this go? So this is their their underwriting process. And I'm telling you, this has been a very fascinating because there's been a small town country bank. Their underwriting is completely different than an inner city bank. For example, the country bank, they looked at my financials. Okay, I think we can work with them, with Van and Van Kallenberg, and see how he works. But what we're going to do, we're going to do a site visit. Wow, for real? So yes, they drove up and had lunch with me, and then we walked some assets. Phenomenal bank. And that's, now that's rare. That's a small bank. That's a $250 million bank and below. That's a bank that has, you know, usually the senior vice president is rocking the bank, making majority of the loans. They do have a underwriting process where they may have a board of directors. And what a board of directors is, this is a process where your underwriting is. So your loan officer or senior loan officer or vice president will get your information, ask you some detailed questions, put together a file. Find out what you're requesting, how much money you're requesting to borrow, and then that individual, that vice president, sells you to the board and says, I believe that Mr. Van Kallenberg is bankable, and this is why. And so when he gathers this data, but he also gets character data from other referrals, like he may call on other people that know me. He may, or she may, during the interview process at lunch, find out that I am an author and a speaker and I'm an educator of real estate. I drop that in my conversation. If I'm out teaching people about real estate, obviously I have an understanding of the game of real estate. It doesn't mean I'm perfect. It doesn't mean I'm more bankable. But they need this information because when they go to the board of directors, usually once or twice a week, small banks are once a week, and they go to this meeting to talk about my file, and every bank has a file on you, and in that file, if all the good, the bad, the ugly, who you are, your credit report, your legal documents, if you've been sued, your LLC, is it current? Here's some quick things that a lot of investors fail to see. Keep your taxes, your property taxes, current and on time. Bankers, some experienced bankers, some don't, but they normally pull your taxes and see when you pay them, how often you pay them, and do you pay them on time. Number two, they check your LLC, aka franchise, see if you're current on that, see if it's actually active and not inactive. So you've got to put a particular file or on your calendar on your phone to make sure that you're up to snuff and that you're current. The bad thing to do is that they approved you and then they call you and say, yeah, but your LLC is inactive. And you're like, you act dumb, like, oh, I didn't know. No, don't find any reason for them to look at you in any light, but only the best. You got to keep in mind that the bank needs you and you need the bank. This is a win-win. It's like having children, okay? You can't do it on your own. You got to have someone else involved. I guess so you could beg to differ, you know, test tube baby or something. But the point is, you got to have a mutual consent here. He needs you or she needs you. You need him, okay? So they're not going to ride a loan to you if they're insecure about your abilities of performing on the loan. The worst thing a banker could ever have in their world is a default. And a default could be not only missing payments, but a default could be that you're not honoring the agreement that you have. Like, for example, if you're building a new building and you run short, you mismanage the money for some weird reason, like you had to fire the concrete contractor three or four times and you're $100,000 short, that's could be in a space of default. And I guess we can get into that some of the time. If this is fascinating, man, I'm just on the roll. I'm only on, I just got started in my mind. How much time do we have here? Cool. We're reckoning on 20 minutes. All right. So start small. When they're going to ask you in the interview process, what's your goals? You know, and here's another thing I see a lot of young investors. Hey, man, the bank only allotted me $100,000. Well, that's just to see what you could do and how you respond. But I started out with $100,000, and now each bank I work with is over $1 million. And so that's how you know, it's just like the basic biblical principle. If you can't handle $10, how are they going to give you $100? So, hey, whatever they're willing to give you, prove your worth. if it makes sense to you, but it ramps up. A lot of banks, I just chatted with a friend the other day, and he's like, yeah, the bank only gave me $500,000. I got the $450,000, and I brought another $100,000 loan in, and they wrote it. And then they wrote another one. You don't know what the board is thinking, and they may throttle you down just to see what your personality is like. See how fast you're really working. If you give somebody, okay, you have $1 million to spend, you know, any human being is going to rack up a bill, right? I mean, that's why everyone's in credit card debt. So they start you small and to build a relationship. So just be prepared and find out what that number is, or don't. I'll just start sending stuff to them until they say no. That is a model that I've always built. I just keep going until someone tells me no. I keep pursuing an opportunity until someone says, I always scratch a deal. I closed on a deal that was money amazing, that it was a phone number that I got in my desk. It took me a year later to clean my desk out. I called them and bought the property a year later. I scratched it, but I didn't want to. I opened up my desk and I was like, oh, this phone number. Oh yeah, I forgot about this house. And I called them and it was the perfect time. You scratch every deal until you get the word N-O. Okay? Just like that with banks, with everything that you do. So they're going to be constantly vetting you out the way you communicate. And someone actually called me out on this one time. I was teaching a young investor. I'm like, hey, do not email the bank at 9 o'clock at night. Oh, why? Why? I was like, listen, a banker has banker hours. Okay. It to me, and to some banks that I've spoke with, and I have intimate relationships with banks, why is that real estate investor emailing at 9 o'clock at night? They can't get their stuff done during the day. So use CRM software. Like I use Streak through Gmail. You just Google up Gmail, do Streak, S-T-R-E-A-K, Streak Gmail, and you can add that in. Now Gmail has scheduled emails now. So, you know, sometimes I'll be working at 11 o'clock at night and, you know, filling out a loan application. I'm not going to email at 11 o'clock at night. I'm going to set it to be delivered at 9 a.m. I'm just another tip for you. Hopefully that was a little nugget for you. When I connect with this person for the very first time, or even prior before, I send them all my financial statements. Like I won't say my taxes so much, but my financial statement, I have done this before. I take my social security number off my financial statement because I don't know where this little document's floating through the process of bank underwriting. But what I do is if I find out a bank that someone referred me to that they work with real estate investors, I will connect with them either by phone or in person, usually at a social gathering, see if we can connect. And then I just straight email them my financial statement and say, hey, I just was touching base with you. See if we can do business together. Do you do, you know, and then usually I'll get a call that day. Yep. Let's schedule a time to meet. Because there's just no nonsense. If you send them some, you know, your portfolio is leveraged out 90%, they're not going to call you. But my portfolio is leveraged around 60 to 50%, depending on how many houses I'm selling or buying at the time. But my portfolio is never over 65. If I'm at 70%, now that's my technique because I'm in a gatherer or building process. And it depends on where you're at in your goals of a real estate investor. Are you just cash flowing? Are you buying more assets? Are you building equity so you can use that equity later to buy an apartment building? So these are just some concepts and understanding that you need to understand for the future. But the banker doesn't know that at all on your financial statement. So if you're just starting out, you want to kind of stay within the ratio between 70 and below 50 to 70%. If you're less than 50% on your portfolio, meaning, and give you a quick analysis, if you have $100,000 in value of your portfolio and you owe $50,000, that means your 50% ratio on your portfolio overall. So if you add up 10 houses and each house is $100,000, that would be $1 million, and you only owe $500,000, your ratio would be 50. So you have 20% more or 30% more. And I wouldn't recommend getting that high in leverage, but that's the bankability that you have. So after you meet, you fill out an application. He looks at it. He already knows before we even accept the application, he knows he's going to write to you, or she's going to note that she's going to write to you. And then you ask to order an appraisal. They follow up with you six to seven days, depending on how long the appraisal comes. Then you get a term sheet. That's kind of what you want to know. Then you close, and then you repeat, and you build a relationship. So I wanted to cut this down to 30 minutes. If I covered everything pretty solid for you, great. I'm appreciated. I appreciate it. If I've missed some things or if you want me to elaborate on some stuff, I can do it again. Go walk through Wednesday. My name is Stephen Van Kallenberg. We got big things going on for 2020 in the SavvyInvestors.com. Go to the website. We're updating almost weekly. I would say daily, but I don't want to say daily because it's really not daily. But Savvy Investors is on an overhaul. We're adding new stuff. We're adding new content. We're going to be launching a platform in the next several months where it's going to be off the chain. If any suggestions, we're hiring people right now. If you are a part or want to be a part of great success, I would love to have a meeting with you. Other than that, whatever you do, go buy assets.
What is the Savvy Bootcamp? Are you struggling to get to the next level as a business owner, as an investor? Do you want to multiply your income? Sign up for the Savvy Bootcamp, a strategic and supercharged one-night and one-day event designed to shortcut your learning process and propel you forward. Just value, no upsells, and an intimate setting to build relationships with like-minded investors. We will be covering how personality profiling can make you a millionaire, outsourcing and the nitty-gritty of maximizing your property management, scaling your business through systems and automation, technology hacks you should be using every day, and how to raise private money. Go to www.savvybootcamp.com now to register or to find out more.
Thanks for listening to the Savvy Radio Show. Glide online and listen to our other motivating episodes at SavvyRadioShow.com. Connect on Twitter @LandlordBook and always be buying assets.